Hello everyone and a very warm welcome to this week's Everton Show. 4 wins from 5 in the Premier League and still no goals conceded in the Premier League in 2017. Not a bad start to the year for the Blues, is it? I've got two former Everton strikers with me on the sofa this week. Always a pleasure to welcome the Diamond. And the fox in the box is with us as well, Franny Jeffers. A very warm welcome, Franny. It has been a great start to the year, hasn't it?
Yeah, it has, yeah. I mean, wasn't going too well, was it? I mean, we weren't playing that well and coming into the new year, you know, we weren't expecting too much, but I think, you know, the way we've started, the new year's been great. Tom Davis coming in, been really good, you know. Me in the academy and working with the young lads down there, that's what we want to see. So, not conceding goals and scoring them, always good.
Can't ask for much more. The Manchester City game really kicked it on, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. I mean, that was a real big game in the calendar, wasn't it? And as Franny said, our form coming into Christmas wasn't great Premier League-wise, but certainly since the turn of the year, it's been exceptional. And as Franny mentioned there, you know, if you don't concede them and you're scoring them at the other end, it's a good recipe.
Long may it continue. Plenty more to come, of course, from Messrs Stuart and Jeffers. And this is what else we've got for you this week.
To be fair to Crystal Palace, they had a great chance that Joel saved when it was 0-0. And, you know, that save is as good as a goal for us and it kept us in the game. And thankfully, we kicked on from there.
George Mann, one of the committee, found a field called Mere Green in Goodison Road and said we could develop this as a ground. And of course we know they did because here we are.
I told him I was interested in coming down and he welcomed me down. So it's great to get back. I try and get across to Goodison when I can. But yeah, I mean, very fond memories of this place. It's a fantastic club.
It's a lot easier for me when I'm playing next to like Ash and Seamus, who talk to me and help me through the game. It makes when I play a lot easier and a lot more comfortable for me.
Well, we may have left it late to clinch another 3 points at Selhurst Park, but nobody could deny that we did deserve to win the game. It was another memorable afternoon in South London.
I think that was a message before the game, not to let that great performance last week slip today by coming down here and getting a draw or losing the game, so it was important to get back-to-back wins.
After last Sunday's fantastic win over Manchester City, Everton are on parade at the Palace this weekend. Can they produce another polished performance and claim 3 points here at Selhurst Park?
When we controlled the game, we were by far the better team, the football team, and a lot of ball position, but also very good chances to score the goal.
Morales! Well, it was a great turn and shot, and the save wasn't bad either from Hennessy. Breaks for Funes Mori. Oh, what a stop that is from Hennessy.
Performances of some of the lads was brilliant. Thought the two young lads again were very good, and Ashley at the back. So, you know, we played well all over the park, and, you know, thankfully we got the winner.
I am so proud with my teammates. Obviously, it's so important, these 3 points. And now we need to rest and enjoy these 3 points.
To be fair to Crystal Palace, they had a great chance that Joel saved when it was 0-0. And, you know, that save is as good as a goal for us and it kept us in the game. And thankfully, we kicked on from there.
Punching this ball in, it's headed down and it forces a great save from Robles.
It was a header and there was only what I was afraid out was the long ball and maybe out of set place that they can score the goal. But then you need the goalkeeper, you need the defenders to wake up and to have good save, and that's what Joel did.
Thought we played well and their keeper was brilliant, to be fair, and we just had to keep going. But when it got to the last 5-10 minutes, they were sitting back and hard team to break down, but, you know, thankfully it came. I took my touch and then, to be honest, I thought if I take this second touch away from him, I was thinking maybe I could get a penalty, but I didn't get a touch, so I just put my head down and hit it, and thankfully went in.
Everton may still have an opportunity. Davis has found Coleman to win it for Everton. Seamus Coleman batters it home. for his fourth of the season, and it is just reward for Everton.
Yeah, very, very proud about the team. I know how difficult it is if you beat City. Everybody knows, everybody expects an easy win against Crystal Palace, but everybody knows this place is very difficult to come and very difficult to win. And that's what happened today after the win of last week. That makes me very proud.
A fully deserved fourth away victory of the season for Everton. They've won four of their last five Premier League games now. Seamus Coleman's winner in the 87th minute, giving Everton 3 points on the road. And they've now won their opening three Premier League games of a calendar year for the first time since 2008. Things are looking good for Ronald Koeman.
Graham, you and I were at Selhurst Park for the game. We did leave it late, but we certainly deserved the 3 points, didn't we?
Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt about that. We were the dominant side. I'd probably give Crystal Palace the first 10 or 15 minutes where they set their stall out and came out the traps quickly. But as the game progressed, we were the dominant side. We created the better chances. Again, Wayne Hennessy in the Crystal Palace goal had a terrific game against us. But as the time, the only worrying thing was the clock ticking past in that second half, wasn't it? Were we going to run out of time? But Seamus, wonderful finish. Good through ball from Tom Davis. Good awareness to pick out Seamus and a really cool finish.
As Graham says there, Wayne Hennessy, Welsh international goalkeeper, tends to save his best club form for when he's playing against Everton. And you do get games like that, Franny, don't you, where everything you try, the keeper keeps it out, and at some point you must think, it's just not going to be our day.
Yeah, and normally what tends to happen then is you end up conceding one at the other end when you've been so dominant. But as I say, it's a sign of that we're in good form and that we're keeping clean sheets and scoring late goals, which is always nice.
And four goals now this season for Seamus Coleman. It's great when you've got a defender that can contribute like that.
Well, I think that's the way football is now. You know, every game I watch, the fullbacks spend more time in the opposition box, don't they? That's the way it is now. So we've got one who's really good at doing it and who gets a few goals every season, so it's good to have.
The bar of expectation had been raised by that 4-0 win against Manchester City, so I suppose it was important to go to Palace and get something from the game.
Yeah, very much so. It's all about keeping your momentum going. And as Seamus mentioned in his interview there, no point winning in the style that we did against Manchester City and letting it all come loose again at Crystal Palace. So I think that's what's pleased Ronald Koeman the most, the performance, a dogged performance, a good performance. But as he said there, it's a tough place to go, Selhurst Park. Not many teams come out of there with 3 points.
Mason Holgate, Ramiro, Funes, Mori across the back, a three-man defence, and it's working, isn't it?
Well, it is working, isn't it? Results are showing that. To be honest, I'm not one for a back three, but as I say, we seem to have the players, don't we, to play. Mason Holgate, who's only a young lad, has done really well coming in there. Ashley Williams is in the centre of them, who seems to keep it together. I mean, and if one of them aren't playing, it'll be Jags, and we have got options back there, haven't we?
It was a brave decision by the manager, wasn't it, to put Mason in, because it's a tough learning playground, isn't it, the Premier League, especially for a centre-half?
Well, it is, yeah. But I think, as Franny mentioned, the three at the back, it just helps Mason in some respects, because Ashley Williams is a dominant figure in there. Good talker, really good to have a communicator at the back like that. Jags is, missing out at this moment in time, but we know what a quality operator he is. Obviously, Ramiro gives you the balance with being a left-footer. But Mason on that right-hand side, it's natural to him, because what you normally find is your centre-halves don't really like to leave that penalty area position. Mm. But when you're playing three at the back, in an ideal world, you want your centre-half on the right-hand side to be comfortable to go out towards the byline, give Seamus the freedom to get himself forward, as Franny mentioned. These full-backs these days, they love to get themselves forward. So it's just something that fits quite nicely, and we've got the players that are making it succeed at the moment.
And moving further up the field, you look at somebody like Gareth Barry, who's still a Rolls-Royce of a player.
Yeah, he is. Yeah, I played with Gareth there. In England under 21s many, many years ago. He was a left back then, but he was a great footballer. Could have played him anywhere, Gareth, when he was younger. And obviously playing for us now, he's a cool head, isn't he? He's an old head, and he's great to have around. He helps them young lads, who we've got coming through. The likes of Ross and Tom coming through there. Tom can look at him, can't he? And Gareth can help him along the way, I think, yeah.
Did Gareth have that football intelligence, that superior football intelligence even then?
Yeah, I think he did, because, people say about him, he's getting on now and he's lost his legs a little bit, but he was never the quickest, Gareth. He was just a great reader of the game. That was always one of his biggest strengths, the way he read the game. Even when he played left-back, he very rarely found wingers going past him. I think he had a spell playing centre-half for England under 21s as well. So you knew straight away he was going to be a top player, because he could fill in many positions. You know, sometimes you get tarnished with that. You know, he can't hold down one spot. But Gareth was such a good footballer that he could have played anywhere. And you know, he's doing well for us in the middle of the park there.
Still more than worthy of his place, isn't he?
Oh, very much so. And his experience is vital, especially when you've got a lot of young players coming into the side. So, I mean, it's all looking rosy in the garden at this moment in time. And again, a little cameo performance from Ademola Lookman, where he came on and looked really, really sharp as well.
There's a real good balance of the team at the moment. And that's the end of part one of this week's programme. We'll have a short break, and when we return, we'll bring you some under-23s action, and a local historian will be helping us celebrate the 125th anniversary of Goodison Park. Welcome back. Now, this week saw the 125th anniversary of a landmark moment in Everton's history, a meeting which would trigger an eventual move to a new home for the football club on Goodison Road. But the story is a little bit more complex than merely shifting the goalposts. We asked Peter Lupson, the vice chairman of the EFC Heritage Society and the author of the book Thank God for Football, to explain the background behind Everton Football Club leaving Anfield way back in 1892.
It's widely believed that the split at Everton Football Club was due to the greed of the club's president, John Holding. But in actual fact, that's very unfair to him, because in 1884, he'd acquired a ground for the club at Anfield Road, which was their new home after they'd been expelled from the previous base. A year later, that ground was going to be put up for sale by its owner, who wanted to redevelop the land. If that had happened, Everton Football Club would have gone out of existence. And the committee went to Holding and said, "Will you buy this land to safeguard the future of the club?" He agreed to do it, even though he knew that they had no security and that they could only pay £100 a year rent. And the agreement was that when eventually the income improved, they would then pay the going rate of £240. In 1888, Everton joined the Football League, and of course the revenue from gates made it possible for the rent to be increased to £240 a year. In 1891, Everton became champions of the Football League, and Holding saw this as an opportunity to move up to the next level and proposed selling the ground to the club so that they could expand it to include cycling and other activities, athletics, to generate money all the year round. The disagreement arose over the price. The committee felt he was asking an exorbitant amount for the land, and they couldn't agree on going forward in that direction. The club wanted to continue on a rental basis, but they couldn't agree the amount. And for 4 months, they got nowhere. Meeting after meeting broke down. Consequently, George Mahon, one of the committee, found a field called Mere Green in Goodison Road, and said, "We could develop this as a ground." And of course we know they did, because here we are at Goodison Park. On the 26th of January, Holding realised that he was losing the committee and registered the club officially as his own under his name as Everton Football Club. Mahon appealed to the FA and said, "This cannot be right, because the name of the club is vested in the committee, not in him." Consequently, the FA upheld the appeal and said, "Yes, Everton Football Club exists through the committee. Holding will have to choose another name for his club, which he can continue at Anfield." And that, of course, was Liverpool. On the 15th of March, Holding was expelled from the presidency. That was the official parting of the ways. And so work began on the site at Goodison Road. Unfortunately, they were £1,000 short. And if they could not find that money, they would not be able to stay in the Football League, because they'd have no ground. A consortium came to the help of the committee, and these were largely people involved in the temperance movement, who identified with members of the committee who felt that having a brewer as the head of the club was immoral, because at the time, drink was seen to be a cause of widespread social misery. The money was raised, and because of that, the ground exists. But in addition to the dispute over the different views about drink, there was also a political sphere, because the members of the committee who were anti-drink were active in the Liberal Party, whereas Holding supported the Conservatives, who looked after the interests of brewers. And consequently, we didn't just have a money dispute, we had a clash of values which permeated the whole club. Had Holding been a butcher or a baker, I don't think the split would have happened.
I'll tell you what, Graeme, as the song goes, if you know your history, Peter Lupson knows his stuff, doesn't he?
I think he's got to work a little bit harder on his knowledge, doesn't he, Peter? Unbelievable. No, I mean, it's terrific to have, you know, somebody with Peter's historic background and his knowledge of Everton Football Club is terrific, and it's very interesting to listen to.
An astonishing story to think that Liverpool Football Club might not have existed, but we're probably glad they are, because it wouldn't be the same, would it?
We need the rivalry, don't we? I'm glad we've moved from Anfield, like, and went to Goodison, definitely, but yeah, we need the rivalry, don't we? So,
is the rivalry there right the way through the ranks? You played in many, many academy derbies.
Yeah, I think it's gone a little bit, because, you know, I think when I came through, most of the squad, or all the squad, were British. A lot of them local lads. Mm. Now it's a bit different, isn't it? You know, it tends to be a few foreigners through in there, lads from up and down the country. So, you know, we still know what it means, but I'd say a little bit of fieriness has gone out of the mini derbies, as we call them.
And also, of course, you can't really explain to somebody what a Merseyside derby's like until you've put your boots on and you've trotted out at Goodison or Anfield. Do you remember your first one?
I do remember my first one, and it's something you never forget. I always look back and pick out moments, but you walk up those steps at Goodison and into that kind of atmosphere, it's one of the best feelings in the world. The hairs on the back of your neck are standing up, and just that rivalry, that intensity of the game, is something you can't replace.
And of course, to be sent off in a Merseyside derby as well is something, Franny.
Well, it is, isn't it?
It was handbags, wasn't it?
It was handbags. It was, I think that was the last time we won at Anfield, weren't it? Mm. If I'm right. I think the occasion takes over at times. You know, I was a young lad. I'd watched many a derby from the Annie Road as an Everton fan. We were in front, weren't we? And a few handbags were thrown, and the rest is history.
We were in front for a long time. We had to hold on for an awful long time after Kev gave us the early goal.
Yeah, but I always felt we were in control, Dan. Mm. I did, yeah. I remember that game clearly, as you remember most games. I always felt we were in control, and I should have scored before I got sent off to make it 2. And then obviously sent off, and then I think, you know, we had the better chances, didn't we? You know, when me and Sander were sent off, I think it was Steve Staunton made a great save.
Steve Staunton went in goal, yeah. And we held on and we won 1-0. Brilliant night. Now, on the subject of Goodison, fans will be aware that season tickets for next season have already gone on sale a couple of months earlier than usual. Now, the reason for this is the introduction, at the request of fans and fan groups, of a new 12-month direct debit scheme. So far, thousands of fans have already taken advantage of this new payment scheme to renew their season tickets. And you have until the last day of this month to register through the website. And also, by the way, non-season ticket holders can register interest in one for next season online now. State your preference and any preferred location. Right, let's now see some under-23 football. David Unsworth took his informed players to Wolverhampton Wanderers on Monday night for a Premier League 2 Cup group match. It ended all square.
Everton under-23s battled their way to a 1-1 draw against Wolves in the Premier League Cup on Monday evening. On a chilly night at Telford's New Bucks Head ground, the hosts took the lead 9 minutes before the interval, when Will Randall found the net with this superb drive from the edge of the penalty area. But the Blues responded well after the break, and Wolves goalkeeper Jack Ruddy produced an excellent save to keep out Kieran Dowell's curling free kick. He was at it again soon afterwards to tip John Joe Kenny's volley over the bar after the defender found himself in space following a corner. The eventual equaliser arrived via a penalty 4 minutes from the end after substitute Courtney Duffus was fouled inside the area. Liam Walsh stepped up, smashing the ball down the centre of the goal to earn the Toffees a well-deserved point that keeps them top of Group D.
A decent enough second half performance. Wolves are a very good team. That's two tough games we've had in the cup against them this year. You know, we got a late winner at Goodison early on in the season, and we've got a late equaliser last night. So I was delighted with the reaction the players showed in the second half, and you know, dominated the last half an hour. We were relentless in trying to get the equaliser, and then when we did equalise, I thought we were going to go on and win it, but it wasn't to be. But you know, on reflection, a point was probably a fair result because Wolves are a good team.
Franny, part of the feel-good factor down at Finch Farm is not just the current form of the first team, but also the 23s as well.
Yeah, Runzi's got them going, hasn't he? He's got them playing really well. Some good players in there. Lads that I think can go on and play for our first team, definitely. you know, this lad here, Liam Walsh. For me, he's a top footballer. I haven't seen many like him. Obviously, he's not the biggest, you know, and that'll always be the question mark against him. But I believe he's good enough to play for our first team.
He gets the better of players a lot bigger than him, doesn't he?
He's a top footballer. His football brain went back before him. We spoke about Gareth Barry's football brain. This lad's got a brain like Gareth Barry. Reads the game really well. Knows where to be. Obviously, understands he's not the biggest, so needs to be cuter in other ways, and he's quite good at it.
And he strikes the ball beautifully, doesn't he?
Well, he does. He's got a terrific range of passing. He's got a little bit of an aggressive streak in him as well, which is no bad thing to have in a modern-day game these days. So, yeah, I mean, he's a little bit of pressure the other night at Wolverhampton. I mean, a little penalty with a few minutes to go, but he struck it straight down the middle of the goal and earned ourselves a point in the Premier League Cup.
And he had a successful spell on loan at Yeovil Town, so he's proved he can hack it at professional level.
Well, that'll have been good for him, won't it? Because when you know, there's always that thing about going down the leagues where people say the physicality in League Two, you know, the ball doesn't spend so much time on the floor, and he done really well down there. You know, I know lads who played against him, a couple of my mates at Portsmouth and that played against him and said he was different class. Said he was, the football brain, the football knowledge, the way he went about it, the way he strikes a ball, like you said, the way he passes it, was there to see. And, you know, I believe he can go on and play for our first team.
He's a lovely lad as well, a young lad with a big future. We'll take another break right now, and in part three, we'll bring you Steve Watson. And, of course, we'll talk a lot more to Graeme Stuart and to Francis Jeffers. Welcome to part three. Steve Watson was back at USM Finch Farm last week. The former Blues defender is currently assistant manager at National League club Macclesfield Town and is enjoying the role.
We're doing well. We're doing quite well. We've had a decent run in the FA Cup. We're doing quite well in the FA Trophy and we've just sort of picked up again in the league and hoping to get back in amongst the playoff places. So, yeah, things are going okay if we can keep hold of everybody in January.
How did the opportunity to go there come about?
Well, I live in the northwest. I live probably 3 or 4 miles from Mac. Got a couple of good friends there, and I've been to a few games. And the opportunity came to go and help coach last year, and just made it permanent this year. Enjoying working with John, enjoy the club, and obviously looking to start a career in management at some time. And it's a good league to start in, so I'm enjoying it.
Did you know John asked you that the gaffer there before you? You went to Macclesfield?
Not really, no. I met him a couple of times in various charity games. But the opportunity came where he was looking for somebody to help with the coaching. I wasn't working at the time. I'd just left Birmingham. So, yeah, it was a good fit and I enjoyed it. And as I say, football is a bit of a drug. So once you get back in there, it's very tough to turn away again. So I've enjoyed being there, yeah.
Like you say, have you been kicking your heels waiting for a chance to come about after been out of the game for a few months?
Well, not so much that. It was it was a case of something that suited where I was at the time, and it was a perfect fit. And I've applied for jobs in the conference and came quite close to getting them. John knows that. John knows I'm ambitious, but at the moment we're working quite well together, and we're just looking to try and we've came close the last 2 or 3 years as a club, or Mac as a club, and we're looking to go one better this year.
Like you say, your time at Birmingham and Huddersfield and at Macclesfield, is it all standing you in good stead to make that step up to management?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, working for 25 years as a player under lots of different managers, you learn a lot and you pick little things from everybody. You know, like Keegan's motivational skills were second to none. David Moyes' organisational skills were second to none. And you pick up little things from everybody. And then obviously I've been assistant manager in the Championship. I've been assistant manager in League One and now in the National League. So it's pretty much all bases covered, hopefully when I get that chance.
Why are you down here today then, Steve?
Well, obviously it's great to come back and see all the old guys that we used to work here when I was there. Jimmy the masseur, Jimmy and Tony the kit man, Les is here, Matt Connery, you know, all the lads that I haven't seen for a while. Obviously I used to used to play with GB at Villa. Good to see him again, and I know Jags well. It's just good to get back, but also when you're coaching, you want to come and watch, you know, the top quality players, and you want to see how they do it, so you can go back and tell, you know, see your boys tomorrow and just see, you know, this is how hard they trained, this is what they did. Like, let's see if we can. And it's good. You pick up new ideas. I was lucky enough to bump into the gaffer yesterday. He lives quite close to me, and I told him I was interested in coming down, and he welcomed me down. So it's great to get back. I try and get across to Goodison when I can, but yeah, I mean, very fond memories of this place. It's a fantastic club.
For a coach like yourself, aspiring coach, it's what you want to hear, isn't it? You speak to the manager of Everton Football Club, Ronald Koeman, and he invites you in to watch training.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest with you, he was a bit of a hero of mine as a young player. I used to love the way he played. You know, he was a very elegant centre half. He was an unbelievable striker of the ball. So yeah, just happened to crack up a conversation with him, and obviously I've been down here. You know, obviously I knew and played under David. I could get down when I wanted. I've been down a couple of times when Roberto was manager, but first time I've been here since Ronald's been in charge. And obviously coming off the back of a fantastic performance at the weekend, it's. The tails are up, and there's a really good chance for 4 or 5 games coming up to get back and bridge that sort of little gap to get back in amongst the sort of European places. So it's a really good feeling around the place.
You've already alluded to the fact you pick up bits and off different managers you come across in your career. You say, obviously, Kevin Keegan's motivational skills, David Moyes' organisation. What have you noticed from your conversations with Ronald and watching training today?
I like his philosophy on football. It's not particularly complicated. Certainly the way he set the team up against Man City, I thought was virtually a perfect setup. I was actually hoping that on Sunday morning when I woke up, I'd done a little segment on TalkSport saying that I hope Everton play with a back three on the afternoon. But with Bainsey and Seamus, probably two of the biggest attacking threats anyway, set up perfectly, and obviously Man City with their quality, they're going to get the odd chance. But I just thought the way that the Gaffer set up rode their pressure, and absolutely ruthless when they got the chances. And I thought it was a really big step forward and a big statement.
And have you had a chance to be around any other clubs as well in the Northwest? Obviously Everton you've got an affiliation to, but do you go around to any others?
Yeah, I mean, I get to a lot of games, certainly 23 games, because they happen to be sort of Monday afternoons and Tuesday nights and things like that, and when we're not playing, get as many as you can, just get a portfolio together, get as many players down in your head as you can, just to progress the future and keep an eye on what they're doing. And you know, who knows, somewhere down the line, you know, I might be a manager in League One, League Two, Premiership, Conference, whoever knows, and it's good to just get a good feel of who's out there and what they're doing.
Good character, Watto. You'd have played against him many a time, Diamond.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, in what position against? I'll never know, because as we talked about earlier on in the show, I mean, you know, about these lads who are good footballers and can play in different positions, and Steve was one of those. You know, he could play fullback, centre-half, centre-forward. Now, you don't play in those positions unless you've got a real good grasp of the game and tactically very, very good.
Scored a hat-trick for Everton against Leeds once.
I know he did, yeah. I remember it. I remember it clearly, yeah. I was in the stands that day, but I remember him scoring a hat-trick. I was just going to say what Diamond was saying then. I played with him at Sheffield Wednesday as well. And I think at Sheffield Wednesday, he played in every position apart from in goal.
So he was great around the dressing room as well for him, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was a good lad, Watto, yeah. He liked a bevy as well, so, you know.
So he fitted in.
He fitted in, yeah.
Let's go right back to the beginning. Franny, we had a good little afternoon at Finch Farm a couple of months ago, myself, Michael Ball, yeah. Keith Sullivan and you, talking about the old days in the FA Youth Cup. And of course, that team got to the FA Youth Cup final, but you were needed for the first team, weren't you, at the time?
Yeah, but, I mean, I wanted to play. And I think, you know, we felt like we had a good chance in it. I'd gone all the way with them in the competition. And, you know, I wanted to play. That was the way I was, you know what I mean? They were all the lads that I'd come through with, and we'd had a good run in it. And I think it was Wofford away in the semi-final. We'd gone down there, and I got rushed to hospital with my heart, didn't I? So I missed the final, first leg of the final. I was out for about a month and a half and got back and played in the second leg, and we managed to win it, which was always, you know, it was lovely.
I do remember that. That must have been a really, really worrying time for you and your family.
Well, it was, yeah. It was just, you know, we went down there on the bus to Wofford the night before, and I just felt a bit unwell, really. And then during the night, you know, a few pains in my chest and started to get progressively worse, and thought I'd had a few too many sweets on the bus coming down, a bit of indigestion, but it wasn't to be, and you know, thankfully I got to hospital and got looked after.
Take some bouncing back, that, Graham.
Yeah, I didn't know he had a heart. But, no, I mean, it is. I mean, you know, fortunately, I mean, I've never been down that road, but I mean, I can imagine how scary a situation that must have been for Franny. But, I mean, it's, you get looked after and it gets caught quickly. He didn't do too bad after that, did he? So, no, he's had a good old career, Franny.
Did you feel the pressure as a young boy, as a young Evertonian that had gone from the terraces to the first team arena?
No, not really, that, I don't know. You know, I just had a dream that I wanted to play for Everton. And I was fortunate enough that it came true. And I never ever felt pressure playing for Everton, to be honest. It was just something I got used to. And as you progress in your career, you know, I'd gone to Lillishaw, so I'd moved away from home at a young age. So, you know, I always had that, you know, that desire to become a professional footballer. I left home, I think it was 15, to live away from home for 2 years, which was tough. You know, but I knew along the way that these were the sacrifices I had to make to become a pro.
You were at Lillishaw as well, weren't you?
Yeah, did exactly the same thing. And it is a big decision. You're 14 years of age. You know, you're probably not quite comfortable enough to really want to leave home at that time. But, you know, I did. I felt it was a situation where, you know, a great opportunity to work with Dave Sexton as well on a daily mm. basis. I mean, somebody as good as Dave Sexton was as a coach was too good an opportunity for me to turn down. So, you know, it's sacrifice is the word Franny uses, absolutely right, because you do anything to make sure you give yourself the best opportunity to fulfil your dream and to become a professional footballer.
And your reward, I would think, for you, Franny, was every time the ball hit the back of the net when you had the Royal Blue jersey on.
Oh, yeah, definitely, yeah. I mean, you know, I'd done a presentation for the Academy, the awards last year, and I was asked, I don't know whether it was you asking me the question, Staz, about playing for England. Never came close to pulling on the shirt for Everton. You know, the feelings that gave me. You know, I know it's a really proud moment playing for England, but my dreams were always about pulling on that blue shirt at Goodison, scoring in the Gladys Street.
We'll speak a little bit more about that game for England in part four of the programme, but the fans took to you straight away, the Everton fans, didn't they?
Yeah, I think they did, yeah, because, you know, I managed to hit the ground running, really. Got a couple of goals quickly, and, you know, the Everton fans, I like that, aren't they? You know, they want to see their own, don't they? You see it now with Tom Davis. Mm-hmm. You know, they want to see their own in the team, and when I got in the team and scored a few goals, yeah, they really took to me.
And showed a bit of passion as well. They like a good celebration, the Toffees. That's us done for part three of this week's Everton Show. In the fourth and final segment, we'll speak to Mason Holgate, and we'll hear from Sky Sports Deadline Day main man, Jim White. Welcome back. Now, the January transfer window slams shut next Tuesday night at 11 o'clock. Now, deadline day just wouldn't be the same, would it, without Jim White constantly checking his phone and regularly updating us on the wheeling and dealing going on in world football. Jim was at Selhurst Park last weekend, and after the game he spoke to the Everton Show, telling us that he's been impressed with the Toffees transfer business so far.
I was thrilled today at Crystal Palace at the match today. I sat beside Steve Walsh, and great seeing him again. But of course, he was centrally involved in the club getting Lookman, and he was telling me all about why he thinks he's going to be such a success here at Everton. And I agree with him. He's busy, he's bright, two great feet, and he'll be a huge success here.
And Morgan Schneiderlin, everybody knows all about his quality.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, he's an absolute Rolls Royce of a player. You're right, Darren. Quality. He's going to give Everton, I think, a real injection of what they need. A busy player who's always up to it, always at it, never stops. And, quality is the word.
A couple of weeks of the transfer window to go. Jim, do you think you're going to be busy?
I think we are going to be busy. I hope Evertonians, we will be busy. I hope I'll be busy on your behalf. I reckon Everton will do well. I think they'll add to the ranks again. When you've got a guy like Mashiri at the top, he always wants a club to go in the right direction, Darren. Wants them to improve all the time. I think I will be busy. It's always the same, Darren, with me on deadline day. Expect the unexpected.
How long is deadline day for you?
like 12 months of the year, mate. No, it's a busy day, and now I'm on Talk Sport in the morning. I'll be in the radio in the morning, then hammer across the city to head to Sky. I'll be on with Hayley McQueen, I can tell you, later that night, and we'll be on right up until the very end. But as you know, Darren, there's a full programme of Premier League fixtures that night as well. So it's going to be busy right across the board, but it'll be brilliant. Will this be busy? Will it have stories for us? You bet it will.
The irrepressible Jim White Diamond. It wouldn't be the same transfer deadline day without Jim, would it?
No, it certainly wouldn't. I think we're all watching Jim. Last day of the transfer window, that's for certain. And he's a, you know, great character. Managed to catch up with him after the game on Saturday, and he was full of the joys of spring at our 3 points, that's for certain.
Interesting that he mentioned Steve Walsh there as well, who's pictured there getting an award from his peers for his work in recruitment. He was down at St George's Park, the FA headquarters. Good recruitment at the right time, getting the right people. It's a cocktail, isn't it, that you've got to get right?
Yeah, of course, and that's why it's important that we got somebody in like Steve, who's well, very well thought of, clearly. And, you know, so far so good. Ademola Lookman has come in, and he's looked really, really sharp in the way things are. And, I mean, I think it's important all the way through the football club. 24/7, every single day of the week, we've got to be on our toes, looking out for these young players. And if we can get people in the building that can improve our squad, we've got to do it.
And that goes all the way down to the academy, Franny, as you know too well.
Definitely, Darren. I think the most important part of the football club, down at the academy and for the first team, for me, is recruitment. Mm. You have to have the right people in there doing it. You know, it's a tough job, to be fair, in the academies, because, you know, you got your Man Cities and people like that trying to take every player on the earth at the minute. So it's tough at the academy end, but it's so important that you get the right type of player in.
Over your careers, you two must have spent a few bob on removal vans, because you had a few clubs, didn't you?
Yeah, he had a few bob, I didn't. But no, I mean, I never went to a football club with the intention of, you know, going in there and coming out as quickly as possible. I always went there and wanted to succeed. I think Sheffield United was the quickest one. I was only there for 15 months, but that was more because, you know, at boardroom level there was a little bit of upheaval, and, you know, your players were getting sold along the line. It was like a conveyor belt, and it just happened to be my time. But certainly at Everton, I was there for 5 years. Charlton, you know, where myself and Franny's paths crossed again, I was there for 6 years. So, you know, I didn't jump ship, Daz.
What was he like at Charlton, this fella?
He was good, you know. It was. I think he had a difficult time, and I felt for Franny because, you know, he came in and, you know, scored goals quickly, but for what one reason or another, Curbs didn't, you know, seem to fancy you, Franny, did he? I mean, I don't know. Tell me why. I've never found out to this day.
No, I don't know, really. I think, you know, I went there and, as Diamond said, I scored two on my debut against Aston Villa at home, I think it was. We beat and we went away. That was on the Wednesday night. We went away to City on the, I think the Saturday or the Sunday, we got beat 4-0. And clearly, you know, the manager was looking to make changes and he left me out. And then there was a few words exchanged. And let's say it never went too well from there.
So you carried the can for a 4-0 defeat at Man City?
Well, yeah,
a little
yeah.
bit harsh. But transfers, sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. Yeah. It's football.
Oh, it is. I mean, I've got to be really, really honest looking back on my career. I went to Arsenal too soon, you know. It wasn't the right move for me. You know, it was a difficult time because of the way our football club was then. Mm. You know, it's not like it was now or like it was even 5 years ago. You know, it was a good move for me and the club at the time, but for me personally, it was definitely too soon and probably the wrong move.
We'll speak a little bit more about that very shortly. Another young player, Mason Holgate, has really established himself as part of the first team picture this season. The 20-year-old has been part of a central defensive threesome in the last few weeks, and it's a role that the boy's delighted to have.
I've played it a few times before, but it's something that we're adapting to, and I think we're adapting well with it. It gives us a lot more time to play out and get on the ball, so I like it as a defender, and I think we're getting well and getting down with shape of it well.
What have you had to adjust to, switching to a back three?
I think we're all pretty much comfortable with it, so only adjustments we have to do is just keep talking to each other and making sure that we're all on the same wavelength, pretty much.
Certainly for you, had a good game against Leicester, and you must have been quite pleased with your own performance against City.
Yeah, I thought I did all right, but it's a lot easier for me when I'm playing next to like Ash and Seamus, who talk to me and help me through the game. It makes my, when I play, a lot easier and a lot more comfortable for me.
I was going to ask you certainly about Ashley Williams. I mean, what a player to play alongside.
Oh, yeah, he's great. Yeah, talks me through everything. Get on well with him, so it makes it a lot easier for me coming into the team, because I know that he's not going to tell me anything wrong. Like, whatever he tells me, I know it's going to be right, so it makes it easier for me.
Mason Holgate's been a terrific signing, Diamond. We are talking about transfers, and they can be hit and miss. No club, no manager gets every one right.
No, of course they don't, but certainly we've got one right in Mason Holgate, that's for certain. And he's come in, and I think he's somebody who's benefited from having a really good pre-season. And I know for a fact he impressed Ronald straight away with his attitude and the way he went about his business. And he's pretty much been in and around the first team squad the whole of the season. Mm. And great credit to him as well. And he's really flourished, certainly, in the last month as well.
Let's just go back to your move to Arsenal then, Franny. Why was it too soon? Why didn't it work out?
Probably because I'd gone from being a regular at Everton, and I went down there and, you know, I couldn't get into the team. And I feel it affected me. You know, I think my head was turned a lot. You know, I think back now, you know, when you're sitting at home and you think back how your career's gone, you know, I think about the amount of agents that got involved in them deals and, you know, the type of things they say to you at the time. And, you know, I feel my head was turned. I was only 19, I think it was. And, you know, it was difficult because I felt Arsenal were the best team in the league at the time. Mm. I just watched them play Liverpool in the FA Cup final and absolutely batter Liverpool and come off losing the game. And I knew there was interest, and it was, you know, it was always on the cards, to be honest with you, Darren. And it was, you know, it was a tough decision for me because, like I say, I'm the biggest Evertonian around. I had a season ticket all my life, and it was a big decision, and it was one that never worked out for me.
What was Arsene Wenger like with you?
He was top man. He is. He's a great gaffer. You know, when there was talk of him, you know, the Arsenal fans turning against him a little bit, and England never had a manager. England should have just went and got him. Quite simply, you know, he's a good manager I've ever worked for. And I think he'd have been really, really good as the England boss. But as I say, he's got a Southgate now, so we'll see how that goes.
And talking of England, to have one England cap is terrific for a professional footballer. Should you have had a few more?
Probably with the ability I had, Darren, yeah. You know, that might sound big-headed, but probably should have had a few more. And in all fairness, I don't think I'd have got one England cap if it weren't for the goals I was scoring for the under-21s, because I got the England cap while I was at Arsenal. Mm. And I weren't playing any football there. You know, the only football I got at that time was the odd FA Cup appearance. And then when I'd go away with England under-21s, where I was scoring quite regular going away with them, and I think, you know, Sven just thought, you know, why not? Let's give him a go.
It was a proud night for Everton Football Club, wasn't it, Graham, with Franny and a certain Wayne Rooney up front for him?
Yeah, of course. I mean, it's terrific to see, you know, two young players that have come through the ranks at Everton Football Club and representing the country. It doesn't get any better than that, unfortunately. I never had that honour, but certainly for Franny and Wayne. I mean, Wayne's gone on and been the player that we all knew he would be. Mm. And maybe this man, as he says, should have got a few more.
Did you know Wayne would break every record going?
No, but he had the ability to, I knew that. You know, he was a phenomenal lad, phenomenal talent. And you know, the records don't surprise me. You know, you don't think when a young lad like that at 16 breaks on, you know he's a good player, but you never expect him to go on to do what he's did. And for me, you know, I said it, I've argued with people on stats alone, he has to go down as one of the greatest.
And he's one of our own as well. Yeah. And that's it for this week's programme. Of course, we'd much rather be in the FA Cup, but nevertheless, do enjoy your free weekend. My thanks to the Diamond and the Fox in the Box for joining us this week. We've enjoyed your company as well, and we'll do it all again in 7 days' time on the Everton Show.